Friends, welcome to worship for Sunday, March 26, 2023, the fifth Sunday of the Lenten season. Next week, we will observe Palm and Passion Sunday, remembering Jesus' entry into Jerusalem to the crowds, waving palm branches, and celebrating his life and ministry. We'll also think about the last week of his earthly life, how the crowd could change so quickly from shouts of "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord," to shouting "Crucify him." All this means that this year's Lenten journey is drawing to a close. Holy Week and then the miracle of Easter will soon be upon us. It's tempting to rush through to the end, to the miracle that we know is waiting for us with the stone rolled away and the empty tomb, but we have to wait. As if trying to remind us of this, the first day of spring happened this week, and then on the second day, I woke up to snow flurries and this drizzly rain. Winter isn't quite ready to let go, and spring isn't quite all the way here, at least not just yet. We have a little more waiting to do until all the spring flowers are up, and it's time to start thinking about planting seeds and dreaming of summer adventures. And in the life of faith, we have a little more waiting to do, preparing our hearts and our souls and our spirits for what is ahead, all that must still happen before we can stand beside the tomb on Easter Sunday with shouts of "Christ is risen." So I'd invite you to do what you can this week, to slow down. Take some breaths, as deeply as you can. Leave earlier than you need to for your destination, which will also help with the road construction around Black Creek. When you're in the checkout line and the person in front of you is struggling with coupons and the card reader and a bag of jelly beans that don't want to ring up properly and you're starting to get frustrated, try practicing your patience and asking yourself where God is in this moment. And in all things, open yourself to what the Spirit is trying to teach you, asking you to do in this moment, in the world, with all of who you are and all of your particular gifts and talents. Slow down. Listen. And together we will change the world for the better. In prayers, we hold California in our hearts. Already dealing with so much rain and snow, they are experiencing even more storms with strong winds toppling trees, causing power outages, and so much more trouble. In Africa and the South Pacific, the devastating effects of Cyclone Freddy continue to be felt in New Zealand, Mozambique, Madagascar, and Malawi, where incredible flooding damaged the nation's electrical power system and killed more than 500 people. We continue to pray for Ukraine as the war continues and for all the other places where there is fighting, violence, and upheaval, including Sri Lanka, Peru, Haiti, India, Pakistan, Israel, and France. Prayers continue for Turkey and Syria as they begin the monumental task of rebuilding after the recent destructive earthquakes. In parish prayers, please keep our Arbuta Schneider from Cecil in your prayers as she deals with some health challenges and needs help from her family to be able to stay at home. And there are several members of our parish, indeed lots of folks we know as well, who are struggling with anxiety, depression, and other concerns. The weight of the world seems to be pressing down on lots of folks, and it's a lot to carry. So go gently with everyone you meet, as you never know what they might have in their hearts and minds. In all things, we remember our connections to one another and our dependence on God, who can see further than we can dream or imagine, to a place where there is true and lasting peace and justice for all people and all creation. We hold on to that vision of the kingdom as we do all we can in our time and place with the skills, talents, and resources we have to work for that kingdom right now. A reminder that the Wisconsin spring primary election is Tuesday, April 4th. You can find more information about what is on your ballot at myvote.wi.gov or by calling your town or village clerk's office. In parish news, the Easter flower dedication deadline is Sunday, April 2nd. And this is the schedule for Holy Week and Easter. Sunday, April 2nd, Palm and Passion Sunday, with worship at all three parish churches at the usual time, as we celebrate Jesus' entry into Jerusalem and think about the last week of his earthly life. Thursday, April 6th, Maundy Thursday, worship is at Cecil at 6 p.m., remembering the last meal Jesus shared with his disciples and friends. Friday, April 7th, Holy Friday, worship is at Black Creek at 7 p.m., remembering Jesus' arrest, trial, and crucifixion. Sunday, April 9th is Easter Sunday. Trijo, Trinity, and Cecil combined are sharing worship at Trinity at 8:30 a.m. with breakfast to follow, and Black Creek has breakfast at 8:30 a.m. with worship at 10:15. Please remember that I am here with you and for you. Together, only together, can any of us get through this life. And now, I invite you to bring yourself to a spirit of worship. God of all life, you are the one who hears and acts, the one who fills us with grace, the one who offers us eternal life. May this time of worship give us strength to trust in your grace and follow in your footsteps. Our first hymn, There Is a Name I Love to Hear, you might also know as Oh, How I Love Jesus, and is a reminder of the peace and hope we can find in trusting Jesus' presence in our lives.
There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing its word that sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Tells of one whose loving heart can fill my deepest woe, who in its sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me.
And together, let us pray, remembering the Spirit's presence with us always. Loving God, in these holy days, help us to open ourselves to Jesus' example in our lives. He resisted the temptations of the world, trusting in you for all he needed. He resisted the temptations of greed and power, sharing his life with all those in need of your abundant love. He resisted the temptations of selfishness, working to create a community of welcome for all. Help us keep his example in our hearts and minds, that we might be transformed during this season of Lent. In faithfulness and hope, we pray. Amen. And now, joining our hearts and minds together with Christians around the world and throughout time, we trust in God's promise to hear us, the joys and struggles of our hearts and minds, and in the power of prayer to encourage us in our life of faith. Let us pray. Holy God, we come to you in thanksgiving for all the blessings of our lives. We thank you for friends and family, for community in our parish, for all the ways you provide for and connect us one to another. Remind us that you are with us always, in all that life brings. Help us to see the goodness, kindness, compassion, connection, and hope that surround us every day. Keep us ever aware of all that ties us together as your people and your beloved creation. Inspire us that we might see your presence in the faces of our friends, our family, strangers, those we believe are our enemies, and in our own faces. Help us to believe that there is no one you do not love, and guide us that we might live from that belief, showing and sharing your love with all. We give thanks for our congregations and our parish and all the ways you bring us together to learn and grow as your people. Inspire us all that we might walk more fully and faithfully in the path that Jesus showed us, that we might widen the welcome and share your love with all we do and say. We pray for those who stand in harm's way in our name, soldiers, sailors, firefighters, police officers, and first responders. Keep them safe as they do their work. We pray for all who provide for us all that we depend on, and those whose work is so often unseen and taken for granted. Help us to be truly grateful for them and to share our gratitude more clearly. We pray for all who work in healthcare in any way and pray they might have the courage they need for the days ahead as they deal with the challenges of our own and our collective health. We pray for our students, teachers, staff, aides, and families. Guide and inspire them and give them the strength that they need. Excuse me. We pray for those in government, entrusted with the sacred responsibility of leading our communities and the world. We pray that particularly those in government in the United States might help us find a way forward that works to end all that divides us. Guide their hearts and minds on the path to peace for us and for all creation. We pray for those who are seeking places to live in safety and hope. Be with those who are resettling here in the United States as refugees, and remind us that almost all our ancestors came to this place as refugees and immigrants. We pray for those who are struggling in body, mind, and spirit. May your grace come to all in need, particularly those recovering from hospitalization and surgery, including our Beauty Schneider, those dealing with the challenges of cancer, those dealing with addiction in its many forms, those with mental health concerns, those who are imprisoned, those dealing with isolation, fear, and worry about this time in their lives and in the life of the world. Be with us all. Fill us with your loving kindness. We pray for those who are grieving, whether the loss is new or many years old, and all those whose hearts ache for someone they love. We pray for those whose private grief has become public. Bring us comfort and help us to trust in your promise through Jesus of life everlasting. We pray for the places around the world that are living under the shadow of war, violence, disease, disaster, famine, and so much more. We pray for our country, O God, as we continue to be plagued by the senseless destruction of gun violence, tearing apart communities and lives. We pray for an end to this violence and a way forward that rids us of the epidemic, providing love and support for those who have been most directly affected, and a path forward in legal and community circles to create a safer future for all. We pray with heavy and broken hearts for those in Turkey and Syria after recent earthquakes. We pray for Ukraine as the brutality of war continues. For Peru and Brazil, for Iran, Haiti, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh, for India, Pakistan, Chad, Syria, and Yemen, for Tigray, Burkina Faso, and Colombia, for Argentina and Afghanistan, for South Sudan, Ethiopia, and the Horn of Africa, for the Uyghur people and the Rohingya people, for China, Palestine, and Israel, and all the places in need of your healing love. We pray for all the people dealing with extreme weather, including flooding, wildfires, drought, famine, and destructive storms in every place, O God, where your people are struggling. We pray for those who are helping communities affected by these extremes, bringing aid and companionship. We pray particularly for California dealing with yet more storms, for Malawi, Madagascar, Mozambique, and New Zealand after the destruction of Cyclone Freddy. And we pray for our collective will to do all we can to help heal our planet. From the depths of who we are, we pray for your peace to come to all this world you love so very much. Be, O God, with the families of the missing and murdered Indigenous people around the country. Be with all who are victims of violence, sexism, racism, and the interconnected isms that cause hatred and discrimination. Help us to be honest about our shared history, particularly the history of slavery, residential schools, and sexism. Be with our country as we face the challenges of living together. All of us with different thoughts and experiences, guide us that we might work with you to create a new world, a way forward that honors the dignity of all people, that recognizes your presence in all people and all creation. Remind us how much we need you and each other. Remind us that our faith is not just for us, but is your call in our lives to reach out to those in need with our words and our actions, that your kingdom might come in its fullness. Help us hold on to the peace that you give, a peace this world cannot provide and cannot take away. Renew our hope, strengthen our faith, deepen our patience, and inspire our hearts, O God. Give us all we need for whatever lies ahead. And together in hope, we pray the words that Jesus would teach his first disciples, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our next hymn, Teach Me, O Lord, Your Holy Way, is a prayer that we might follow Jesus into a life of service to the world.
Teach me, O Lord,
And now we come to a time of confession, knowing that we need God's love to fill our lives and trusting in God's grace that will receive us and bring us to new life. Let us pray. God of love, you create us in your image and ask us to share in your work of caring for creation. You call us to be your hands and heart in this world. You invite us to join you in the work of creating justice for all your children. We confess that we often fall short of what you want for us. We let our fears overwhelm us. We neglect our faith. We rely on the empty promises and easy solutions this world offers us. We refuse to let your grace into our lives. We doubt your ability to change things. Receive us and forgive us. Open our hearts and minds. Guide us that we might grow each day into the people you know we can be. Strengthen us that we might truly follow you. Encourage and hope, we pray. Amen. And now, in this time of silence, we bring our own personal concerns and needs to God's forgiving love. Hear the good news. God loves you. God is with you today and always offering you forgiveness, grace, and hope. Thanks be to God. Excuse me again. We continue our readings in John's Gospel today with the story of death and resurrection. Reading from John chapter 11, verses 1 through 27, adapted from the New Revised Standard Version. Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the leaders of the Jewish people were just now trying to stone you, and you are going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of the world, but those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been talking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many people from the city had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of them." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." Our next hymn How Firm a Foundation is one of my favorites, a reminder that God is the foundation of our lives, and with that, we can face all that life brings.
To affirm what we've just heard from Ligon.
How firm a foundation, you saints of the Lord, it is laid for your faith in his hand.
And continuing the story of Lazarus and his sisters, we read from John chapter 11, verses 28 through 45, adapted from the New Revised Standard Version. When Martha had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." When she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The people who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the people who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the people said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, God, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, unbind him and let him go. May God add a blessing to the reading, the hearing, and the living of these scriptures. We continue reading these long stories in John's Gospel, ones that if they were told in other Gospels might be quick little glimpses of things Jesus did. But here they're used as object lessons, stories that are designed to help us more deeply, more fully understand Jesus's teaching, his life, and his ministry. We had Nicodemus, the Pharisee, a member of the religious leadership of his day, who came to Jesus by night. And they had that conversation about being born of the Spirit, born from above, if you truly want to inherit the kingdom of God. Then we had the woman at the well, but not just any woman, a Samaritan woman, an enemy of all that people of faith stood for. And we thought about what does it mean to receive life-giving, living water that Jesus provides that can nurture our spirits through all that life brings. And last week, we had a man born blind, healed by God and restored to his community. And we thought about the challenges of legalism in our faith, of drawing the lines of in and out when Jesus asks us to draw a great big circle that includes everyone. And now we come to what has become one of my favorite stories in Jesus's life and ministry. It seems this man named Lazarus, who lives in the city of Bethany, is ill. Lazarus has two sisters, Mary and Martha, and all three of them are very good friends of Jesus. And the sisters are worried, so they send word to Jesus, hoping that he will come, will offer his healing powers and presence to Lazarus, and all will be well. But strangely, when Jesus receives the news that his friend is sick, he doesn't rush to his bedside. He doesn't even seem to hurry. He stays where he was, doing the ministry that he was called to in that place for 2 more days. And when he finally does decide it's time to go to Bethany, a city near to Jerusalem, the disciples are not sure that he should. Doesn't Jesus remember that the leaders of the temple and synagogues were just trying to kill him? Is he sure he really wants to go back there, even if his friend is sick? Jesus knows about the threats to his life, but he trusts in the work that God has set before him. And Jesus knows, the scripture tells us, that Lazarus has already died, but still off towards Bethany they go. And along the way, while they're still outside of the city, sure enough, word comes to them that Lazarus has died and been buried in his tomb for 4 days. Martha comes out to meet Jesus, but Mary stays at home weeping and grieving. And out there on the road to town, Martha and Jesus talk. She's convinced that if Jesus had been there, her brother would not have died. But Jesus reassures her that the dead will rise again, that he himself is the Messiah, the one coming into the world to bring all people to God. And then, accompanied by this crowd of mourners who are grieving with her, Mary comes out to Jesus and she makes the very same plea. If Jesus had been there, her brother wouldn't have died. Then they go to the tomb, and as they approach it, Jesus stops to weep for the death of his friend. Then, getting to the tomb, Jesus commands them to roll the stone away and release Lazarus from the tomb, but the crowd objects that, like, surely it's been 4 days. It's going to be quite, stinky, Lord. But Jesus persists, and the stone is rolled away, and he calls to Lazarus, who emerges from the tomb restored to life. At my ordination to become a pastor, we had 2 sermons. One of them, from a seminary classmate and friend, was about this story. My friend Thomas said that if he had to choose any of the stories of Jesus, any of the things he did, the miracles he performed, his sermons and his teachings, he would choose this story, the raising of Lazarus, to describe my life and ministry. It seems strange to me. Surely I thought it would be one of the feeding miracles, a time Jesus sat down to share a meal with folks from so many different walks of life. Or maybe it would be when Jesus taught over and over and over again about love and service. Or maybe it would be that wonderful bit in the 25th chapter of Matthew about clothing the naked and visiting the sick and imprisoned. But no, Thomas insisted. It was the raising of Lazarus that described and defined what he saw in me and my ministry. It was, he said, a question of timing, of knowing, as the book of Ecclesiastes teaches us, that there is a time, a season for everything under heaven. When Jesus receives word that Lazarus is sick, he knows that he has the power to heal him. We saw him just last week, after all, healing a man born blind, and we've heard so many other stories of the lame who regain their ability to walk, and the deaf who can hear, and the bleeding woman who is made well, and so many more. Jesus knows, while he is still far away from Lazarus and his sisters, that he has everything it takes to make him well. But Jesus also knows it's not quite time. Not just yet. So he waits. He stays where he is and tends to the ministry and the work that he has where he is when he receives the news of Lazarus's illness. We don't know where he was or what he was doing, but it was clearly important enough to Jesus that he needed to stay there and tend to the faithful and the hungry and the sick and the needy and the worried and all of the people in need of God's grace in that place before he moved on to Bethany and Lazarus. Only when that work is done, when the time is right, does Jesus get up and go to Bethany. And receiving word that Lazarus has already died, he continues his journey knowing that he will have all that he needs to do the work of God when he gets there, knowing that he has the power to literally raise the dead. But what does he do when he gets there? Does he go directly to the tomb and wave his arms and call heaven and instantly invite Lazarus to come up from the earth? No. First, he comforts and consoles Martha and Mary. And then, this is the really important part, my friend Thomas said, Jesus stops and weeps. He lets himself feel his grief about the death of his friend. Then he stands up and wipes his eyes and proceeds to the tomb, where he does what he knows he is capable of, and he calls Lazarus back to life. A lot of life is about timing, about knowing what is right to do and when to do it. The fancy word for it that's popular in the church is discernment. We have to be about discerning, listening to the movement of the spirit of our own hearts, of the needs of the world, and deciding in every situation what the best course of action is, the most faithful thing to do would be. The world we live in is not good at giving us space and time to do that discernment. Ever more, the world is demanding instant reactions to things, instant responses, instant decision-making. We used to write letters that could take days to cross the country, and now we send emails and texts that appear with the recipient in a matter of minutes or seconds, and the expectation is often that we will respond in a matter of minutes or seconds as well. Even if the subject needs our discernment, needs us to take some time to decide how to reply. And it's not just that. Our whole culture has decided to be in a hurry, expecting that we will rush from one thing to the next, zooming up and down the highway, passing folks who are moving too slow for our liking. We don't sit through television commercials. We want instant reactions and responses. We can't wait for a return phone call, and so much more. I think at least part of the lesson of the raising of Lazarus is knowing that there is a time for everything, and it's okay to not be rushing through this life, to tend to what is in front of us before moving on to the next thing at breakneck speed. We can be in the middle of something and let the phone ring and go to voicemail. We can ignore those text message alerts or not read the emails. We could leave early for an appointment and slow down and drive mindfully and look at the world around us. We could be with the people we are with without thinking about the next thing and the next place we're supposed to do or our list, which is a mile long. We could just be present with one thing before we move on to the next. And we could be discerning what we need to do in each moment, to sit still or to move, to act or to not, to listen or to speak up, to weep or to raise the dead. Every season, every moment of our lives requires something different, needs us to bring a different spirit, but we have to have time to discern that, to think about what is needed, about what skills and gifts we have, about what God is asking us to do, and how God is present with us, and so much more. So as we move into this week, nearly at the end of this year's Lenten journey, I invite you to think about what is needed in this season of your life, in the small moments of your days, and in the bigger decisions about the life that you are facing right now. Instead of rushing through these days, slow down and ponder. Really think about your actions. If what you're doing is what is needed right here and right now, or are you getting caught up in the busyness of the world just for the sake of being busy? Listen to the Spirit's voice, sometimes quiet and sometimes insistent, about what is needed for you, for your community, for the world, and what God is calling you to do. And then together, all of us discerning with each other about what we need and what our community needs and what our parish needs, to be as fully as we can the people God created us to be, then together we will build the kingdom of God's promise in our very midst. Amen. And now, having worshiped together, let us pray in thanksgiving for the blessings of our lives. Gracious God, we thank you for this time together in worship and prayer. Receive the gifts we bring as symbols of our gratitude for all you have given to us. Receive the lives we offer that we might be of service to you in the world. Receive our parish and help us that we might continue our work of creating a community of love and hope for all people. Guide us through all that lies ahead and help us to trust in your presence with us. Amen. And we continue with our Lenten hymn, Let There Be Peace on Earth, a prayer that we might commit our lives, everything we say and do, to the work of God's peace here on earth.
Let there be peace on earth.
and my friends receive this benediction. May the grace of God, the love of Jesus, and the presence of the Spirit bring you courage and peace this day and for whatever lies ahead. Amen.